I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world, millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't give yourselves to brutes. Men who despise you, enslave you, who regiment your lives, tell you what to do, what to think, and what to feel, who drill you, diet you, treat you like cattle, use you as cannon fodder. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men, machine men with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines. You are not cattle. You are men. You have the love of humanity in your hearts. You don't hate. Only the unloved hate. The unloved and the unnatural. Soldiers, don't fight for slavery. Fight for liberty. In the 17th chapter of St. Luke it is written, the kingdom of God is within man. Not one man nor a group of men, but in all men, in you. You, the people, have the power. The power to create machines. The power to create happiness. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful. To make this life a wonderful adventure. Then in the name of democracy, let us use that power. Let us all unite. Let us fight for a new world. A decent world. That will give men a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power. But they lie. They do not fulfill that promise. They never will. Dictators free themselves, but they enslave the people. Now let us fight to fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason. A world where science and progress will lead to all men's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!
Now, going into the history of some of the projects which went on there, one has to go back to Nazi Germany in the period of time prior to World War II. And during World War II, they were working feverishly on mind control projects. There were a number of people who were involved with these who were smuggled into the United States in the period from 1933 to about 1942. And I don't think we didn't smuggle them out under the war years, because underneath all of the facade of this world war, and we were going to bomb the blazes out of Germany, which we did later, there was a lot of covert cooperation between the two governments on research. Now, this is hard perhaps for some people to accept, but it is a fact which can be proven. Number one item, which has nothing to do with the Montauk Project, but which helped to maintain the stability and the functioning of the German military through the major part of World War II, was the fact that when all of the Ploesti oil fields were bombed and blown up and they had no more oil left for gasoline, guess who comes to the rescue? Standard Oil Company of the United States, New Jersey, and gave them the process for converting coal to gasoline. which...
So this is an American process. This is not a German process.
That's correct.
I've always thought.
We have always been told it was a German process, which they developed. They did not. It was developed here in the U.S., and that process probably dates back to before the turn of the century, and that's a very long story in itself. In any case, they gave them the process, helped keep the war going, and who knows what other things were done to help keep the German war going, because this war, that is, the one in World War II between Germany and the Allies, was not what it appeared to be. It was not a war of politics. It was not a war of borders. It was not a war of people against people. It was a war of banking interests against banking interests, who, no matter who won or lost, they all made tons and tons of money, because the munitions had to be built to fight the war.
Well, actually, this was a war of the bankers against the whole humanity, because by killing humanity, they were loading the governmental credit cards with these exorbitant astronomical military expenditures, and also they were achieving their targets of limiting the population on the planet, which has very long been the number one goal of the Luciferian lobby on the planet, to reduce the population.
Right, I figured in it, and of course the periodic war does help reduce the population. Most people throw up their hands in horror at the reported stories of 6 million Jews dying in the Holocaust in Germany, which is a total fabrication, but nonetheless many did die, and there's no question of that. It's, the figure is wrong, and who died is wrong, and the causes and the reasons are not accurately reported. Let us say 2 million died in those camps for whatever reason. Does the general public realize that in the bombing raids of Germany, 26 million German civilians died in those bombing raids? The cities were leveled, and when the war was over, Eisenhower himself ordered the German soldiers put in the concentration camps and other local holding areas, cut them off, no food and water, and let the tens of thousands of them die.
This was the book, the Canadian book, Other Losses, that was feverishly debunked even in the tabloid press here, which turned my attention to that. I thought, gee, this must be something very important if they are so angry about the book.
Right. That's usually the case.
It is also fascinating that the European Union issued a poster which was posted all over Europe where they had the Tower of Babel under construction. Can you see that? This was posted all over Europe, and the stars were upside down representing the goat of Mendes. This is Satanism. This is the new Tower of Babel. And the high French politicians said, "We are building a new Babel," which they emphasized with this poster, and this time, see, the new parliament of the European Community is built like the Tower of Babel. In fact, it has a plaque on the inside or a poster which says precisely this. And it has these scaffolding to give the appearance that it is under construction. This is rather arrogant. This is the new European identity card. And if you look at it at the back and you turn it upside down, what do you see? You see the goat of Mendes. The horns are slightly modified to give another symbolism of the seat of the earth. But the inner facial features of the goat are very clearly discernible. And what these mean over here, I would rather not say. If we look at the high politicians of Europe, those that played the role in all of this, they are Masonic. That is a Masonic handshake between Schröder, signifying the new Mason is taking over where the old Mason is leaving. So just as we saw that Kerry is a Skull and Bones member in America now, and the present president is a Skull and Bones member, it doesn't matter which one is going to win. So here, too, Mason replaces Mason. Fingering the system, they're all showing that they're all part of the same system. When the Soviet Union fell, the new emblem that it adopted was this one, the double-headed eagle. Could you guess why? Well, the double-headed eagle is the symbol of Freemasonry, and it obviously shows who is in control. The queens, the kings of the world, as we have seen, All of them are high masons and subject to the Roman pontiff. And Islam, we lecture to show the intrigue of the Islamic religion and the Catholic religion, that behind the scenes, controlled by the secret societies, they have one aim, and one aim alone, subject to Rome. So what is all this war about with Islam? Who are these people who are pulling the strings in the world? And why are people being rubbed up between them? From the rock stars of the world, the Bonos of the world, to the political leaders of the world, everyone seems to be bowing down to the papal Caesar. From the east to the west, the Islamic world is currently being set up as the synthesis in the religious world, pitted against the Judeo-Christian culture as the antithesis, and then out of this must come a synthesis where all of them unite. This is a website. There is the actual website underneath. And this one, I believe, fairly accurately says who's who in the zoo. Adam Weishaupt, Astor, Pike, Carnegie, DuPont, Harriman, Bertrand Russell, Ted Kennedy. These are the Illuminatis of yesteryear and today. George W. Bush, of course, he's a Skull and Bones member. That's a sub-organization of Chapter 322 of a German organization, the Illuminati, therefore. Bundy, Habsburg, Freeman, Teng Hui, Hillary Clinton, Alan Greenspan, Rockefeller, Rothschild, Wahlberg. These are the bankers in the system, the negotiators, Lord Carrington, Jimmy Carter, Henry Kissinger, Lord David Owen, Richard Holbrook. These are 33 degree Freemasons, or Knights of Malta, or Bilderbergers, Committee of 300. They all belong to the same club. If we look at Franklin D. Roosevelt, Engels, all of these, Trotsky, Stalin, Marx, Hoover, all of their affiliations, Grand Orient Lodge, for example, Grand Orient Lodge, Lenin was Grand Orient Lodge, Truman 33 degree, Willy Brandt 33 degree, Winston Churchill. We've seen many of these before. Helmut Kohl, Committee of 300, François Mitterrand, 33 degree Freemason, he is not alive anymore. Yitzhak Rabin, Yasser Arafat, 33 degree Freemason. These are fascinating details. Shimon Peres, Ronald Reagan, George Bush, Gerald Ford. I showed you Gerald Ford's signature where he signed for himself that he was a 33 degree Freemason. There it is. I photographed it in the lodge. And the Carters and these great political people in the world, the Schröders, the Netanyahus, the Gorbachevs, there is Saddam Hussein listed as a 33 degree Freemason. Now, that is somewhat strange, wouldn't you say? King Hussein, Al Gore, Tony Blair, all of these issues. Look at Saddam Hussein over there. Here's a picture of Saddam Hussein. And this is a picture that was beamed on national television during the war. During the war, of what he looked like. Now, they also said at that stage that they weren't sure whether this was pre-taped. That means it could have been pre-taped before the war even took place, because if they are insiders, they would know who's who and what is going to happen. Now, there is a very interesting rumor about this man. Have a look at his face and have a look at the fact that he has no beard. The CIA, as well as the British Secret Service, said at the time it could be a double. It could be a double, but nevertheless, that is what was depicted. He has always looked like this. He's never had a beard. This is what he's looked like. Operation Iraqi Freedom, Saddam Trouble. Opposition leader claims Hussein died of cancer in 1999. This was posted March 26, 2003. Muslim al-Assadi, a doctor living in exile in Iran, said he believes the real Saddam died in 1999 from cancer. The real Saddam died because he had cancer of the lymph nodes, and since his death in 1999, they're just showing his doubles, he told the Italian newspaper. That's a fascinating story. if Saddam Hussein was really dead and the others were pre-recorded stories, then who was ruling in his place? His sons and his wife and his other children were also there. It fascinated me that the moment the war broke out and England and the United States went in there, that the wife and the children of Saddam Hussein, except the two ruling sons, were taken away and received exile where? But in Great Britain. So the country that attacks takes the family of Saddam and gives them political exile in Great Britain. Very strange. Now, if he was dead and they were putting doubles in front and they were ruling really through the sons, and they showed these shot-up bodies of two individuals who nobody knows who they really are, who knows whether that is really so or whether that is not so. Despite the reference to Qaza, British intelligence thought the broadcast may have been pre-recorded. This is a fact. We are well aware that he spent many hours recently tape recording various messages. We have to do a little more analysis of what he was actually saying to see whether or not that in fact was Saddam Hussein. British Defense Minister Jeff Hoon told reporters. White House spokesman Ari Fleischer said, "I think there are some doubts about whether that tape is canned or whether it's fresh and based on recent events." So both of the Secret Services question these issues. Then they find, finally, Saddam Hussein's hideout, the filthy place, they say, and they arrest the man and show him on national television. After that, one does not hear too much. And he has a magnificent beard. A magnificent beard. Now, if the previous one was shot during the war, then this must be the best hair fertilizer that mankind has ever found. Maybe he could become a multi-zillionaire patenting this fertilizer to make this grow as it is. They used at least three doubles. Who knows who this man is? And to say that they did blood tests, who knows whether you can trust the laboratories that did this. Nevertheless, he's listed as a 33-degree Freemason. There are plenty of questions regarding this man, and there is no evidence, except for his family, that is safely living in exile. Royalty, Prince Bernard of the Netherlands is 300, committee of 300, and here Princess Beatrice and Prince Bertil, the Queen, of course, Prince Philip, all of them high Freemasons. Mengele, Walt Disney, all of these individuals. The world is really run by these individuals. Here is the Duke of Kent giving the Masonic handshake under the Masonic shield. He is the current Grand Master. So he is the highest Freemason at the moment, if you like, because a king may not be, or a prince may not be, the Grand Master. He is currently the Grand Master. So here is the highest Luciferian in the country at the moment.
The United States of America is the most powerful nation on Earth. In itself, this goes a long way to explaining the things it does around the world. At present, it's conducting a war on terror, or more accurately, a campaign against opposition to US domination. Others prefer to call it the beginnings of the Third World War. The United States has an insatiable appetite for conflict. And since going into Korea in the 1950s, it's been at war with someone or other in some corner of the globe non-stop right up to the present day. This drive is now led by the weapons manufacturers themselves. It is a highly dangerous precedent. I call it war corporatism. It is the door of a new fascism being pushed open. And don't be fooled, not all fascism looks like Adolf Hitler. The reality, as we see from the Iraqi invasion, is that the presidency has been captured by the most powerful elements of this corporatism. And this ghastly molecule aims to turn the world into its very own enslaved global market. And the plan is well underway. The attack by Al-Qaeda on the World Trade Center is just one response to it. Is this a conspiracy? Quite the opposite. It is a high-profile project known as the Project for the New American Century. People like Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, Richard Perle are the major players among politicians, right-wing thinkers, militarists, and industrialists in the creation of the project. The project is a neoconservative manifesto which includes in its toolbox the unbridled use of war in clearing a path for US interests. The will to attack Iraq came entirely from this visible yet sinister group. September the 11th was merely the pretext. Bush is merely the figurehead. And so, who's next, you wonder? Iran? North Korea? France? Britain? None of us really matter to them.
The victory will be an endorsement of a philosophy. I believe in my heart of hearts the victory in 1998 is going to be good for Texas, and that's the most important thing about the campaign.
Shouldn't we abolish the Federal Reserve and the CFR? That's the real reality that none of you will talk about, most of you are members. That's what's destroying this country, Governor. Don't you stand for America, sir? What about the Federal Reserve and the CFR? You people are being lied to. This country's been taken over by Europe, and I'm being drug out. Laugh at it.
Let's grab an arm. Pablo, assembly. Okay. Where's Carr? I got some cuffs. Let's take him right here, up against this glass. Let's trap him on the glass. Okay. Take that out.
I wish to thank the sponsors for inviting me. I don't often get invited. This was an important debate. I had planned another closing message, but I feel compelled to say what I'm about to say. Now, I risk sounding like a conspiracy theorist, but it's no longer a theory. What I'm about to say is fact. The secret organizations of the world power elite are no longer secret. They have planned and are now leading us into a one-world communist government. The combining of national governments started with the European Union. That union started with trade agreements, then a common currency, the euro, and now a European Parliament that is feverishly passing laws that override the laws of the member nations. A constitution was drafted but rejected by a few of those nations, but never mind. They implemented it anyway. Now it's North America's turn. Building on the North American Free Trade Agreement, the NAFTA section of the Commerce Department is busy drafting laws and regulations for a North American Union, a union of Canada, America, and Mexico. The President has attended secret meetings and signed at least two agreements under the Security and Prosperity Partnership Program. Information leaked out about the meetings, and now it is all in the open. No treaty has been signed, so Congress has not become involved. However, money from our Treasury is now being spent for this effort. We will have a new currency, the Amero, and a new constitution modeled on the Soviet Union's constitution. Our rights will not be inalienable, but they will be granted by government, who can also take them away. One sign that this is our future is the plans for the superhighways from southern Mexico through America and into Canada. These plans are not secret any longer. Huge amounts of property will be taken in the name of free trade, peace, and security. You will have a national ID card with a radio frequency chip in it. That's already law in America and will be implemented by May 2000. This man voted for it. You will not be able to move about freely. This is terrorism of the most worst kind, brought on you by our own government. The strongest, freest nation in the history of mankind will be averaged into world communism. Is that what you want? Are we the people still in control of this nation? We must begin to act like we are.
Stan Jones. On that, Conrad Burns, 3 minutes.
Sure glad you got such a rosy outlook on our future for our kids.
Tonight, a proposal for an expanded so-called free trade zone from Alaska to the tip of South America. It's a plan from the business elites, the political elites, that will cost more American jobs, cost American sovereignty, but it would fulfill the president's father's vision. Bill Tucker reports.
It's not a new idea. President Bush talked about it back in 1991.
It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause.
Now, former United States Trade Ambassador Robert Zoellick is talking about it again with renewed vigor. This time, a new world order with business at the helm of trade and economic policy, advocating what he calls the Association of American Free Trade Agreements, a separate non-government entity which would include North, Central, and South America.
What Zoellick is really proposing here is a stealth trade agenda. It's not a national agenda. He's proposing to set up what's essentially a private organization to try to achieve what he couldn't get done when he was the U.S. trade representative. And this is a business agenda.
It's an agenda that goes hand in hand with the United States, Mexico, and Canada, working quietly and behind the scenes to promote a common market with common deregulation for the benefit of multinational corporations. It's an agenda that so far has resulted in an increase in U.S. corporate profits of 45%, while wages of American workers have risen only 3% in the last 5 years.
The main danger raised by Zoellick's proposals is that the future of American international economic policy, which affects not only our nation's prosperity, but its national security, will be set not by the American people and their elected representatives, but by a small corporate elite that is accountable to no one but itself.
Effectively surrendering the sovereignty of the United States.
And as justification for trusting those who would have the authority, the argument is made that free trade promotes democracy and the welfare of the people. But Lou, one has to look no further than China to see whether that, in fact, is true.
You know, talking about Zoellick's proposal, it's not Zoellick's proposal, it's Daddy's proposal. And people better understand that they mean exactly what they're saying. It's a new world order they're trying to create, and they're trying to do so not only without approval or consent of the governed in this country, but despite the popular will. This is a straightforward assault by the elitists in this country. And appreciate it, Bill. Thanks very much, Bill.
The issue is not the election. The election is a battle in a war. It is not something unto itself. The result of this election in itself is a matter of indifference. It's a question of how the battle is won and lost, which is important. But there's another issue here. There's also an issue of World War III. And World War III is between the British Empire, better known as the Anglo-Dutch liberal banking financial system on the one side, and the principal nations of Eurasia, Russia, China, India, and other nations, are the targets of intended warfare by the British Empire, which is already turning Europe into a mere colony of the British Empire through the program of the Lisbon Treaty. If the Lisbon Treaty were adopted, and it's being pushed for adoption now, there would not be a single nation on the continent of Europe, west of Belarus and Russia, which had any sovereignty whatsoever. The British Empire would control the entirety of that region of Europe, from Portugal to the borders of Belarus and Russia, as a puppet of the Anglo-Dutch liberal financial interests. It is those interests represented in the United States for a long time have taken over control of the U.S. dollar, control of the United States. Now they're moving in for the kill. The same cartel that put Mussolini into power in Italy, the same cartel that put Hitler into power in Germany. And we're now at the brink of something like a Hitler power taking over the United States. If they grab the United States, then they will grab all of Europe under the Lisbon Treaty. If they control the United States and the parts of Europe under the Lisbon Treaty, then you will have an actual fighting war emerging on this planet. You will have dictatorship. You will have mass starvation, the elimination of whole sections of the population of parts of the world through starvation. And that's part of the British program. It's the food war. That's the situation. We're not dealing with an election. We're dealing with whether there is in the United States, in the top layers of society, the moral fitness to survive. And so far, the vote is, in the leadership of the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, neither is morally fit to survive. They're as unmorally fit to survive as the people who backed Mussolini and backed Hitler back in the 1920s and the 1930s. And if we allow this to happen, we will get the same kind of treatment that the victims of Mussolini, Hitler, and so forth suffered. That's where we stand. We have to win this war against that evil empire. Now, for a number of months now, there has been a worldwide food crisis caused by many things, by the financial policies, various kind of management deals, by the WTO, which ought to be eliminated, by the promotion of biofuels, which is destroying food supplies. This biofuel program is a gigantic swindle for which there is no possible justification. None. The justification comes out of the World Wildlife Fund of Prince Philip. Zimbabwe, for example, what's the crime? You have an African population in Zimbabwe, which was one of the biggest fighters against the British Empire. They're not allowed to develop their own territory.
because London, by various mechanisms, prevents them from doing so. And London uses the farms it allows to prosper in former Rhodesia to feed the populations of Britain. So you have non-African farmers running farms, producing food in Zimbabwe for the edification and fattening of Brits. But the rest of the population is inhibited in any attempt to develop. What they've done is they've taken industries, manufacturing industries in particular, agriculture in particular, and countries which were good agricultural producers or good manufacturing producers have been stripped of those industries. Those industries have been taken to populations where the lower 80% of the population is illiterate. So you have colonies of manufacturing in countries in Asia, Africa, and so forth, South America, where the people, the 80% of the population, does not participate in the economy. You have areas which used to be food-producing areas which no longer produce food. Because what you're having is a world dictatorship under the name of globalization, better called the New Tower of Babel, in which the cultures are being destroyed as the United States is being destroyed, as Germany is being destroyed, as Italy is being destroyed, as France is being destroyed, and the attempt to make war on China, India, and Russia. And that's the intent of the British Empire. Nothing less than destruction and breakup of China, the breakup of Russia, the breakup of India. That is the policy of the British Empire now. This is what the game is. And if this game is not stopped, I can tell you there'll be no planet. But then come back to the food question. If you want to get the American people and other people of other nations up on their hind legs, acting like free people rather than battered slaves, tell them their food for next tomorrow morning is not there. That activates popular resistance more than anything else. We are now in such a situation. For many parts of the world, the lack of food is an immediate reality. There is a growing explosion throughout much of the world over this food shortage issue. The rate of food shortage is increasing because the stocking from various food stores, annual stores, has been already delivered. And there's not enough. So as the fact of the empty warehouses and equivalent forms of supplies, as these things go down without food, the food crisis is going to accelerate. And you're going to have not only other parts of the world, but also American citizens who are now faced with the threat of death by food shortages. So therefore, the issue here is not the election result. The issue is not the president. Obama is not competent to be a president. He has none of the makings of competence. They don't want Obama. They just want to use him to destroy Hillary Clinton. That's all. Once they destroy Hillary Clinton, they'll get rid of Obama. That's their intention. And their intention is to bring in a fascist regime in the United States, a presidency which will be, in effect, a fascist regime, which will cooperate with the British and bring the United States into alliance with the United Kingdom, or the Anglo-Dutch liberals. Not all Brits are for this, by the way. But and with a Europe, a Western and Central Europe, taken over by this same imperial power. An imperial power whose intention is to go to war against Russia, China, India, and other countries using nuclear power. That's the intention. We're now in a point where a revolutionary movement, or the makings of it, is building up around the food issue. And therefore, those who triumphed yesterday are not going to continue to triumph for long. The result is either we win and restore the kind of government we require in various nations and among nations, or this world is going to go into hell because the crisis won't quit. The people will die of hunger. They will die in increasing numbers. They will kill for food. The structure of society will be destroyed in the fight over food, which is not there. Therefore, either we win this fight against this evil, or there won't be anything to fight for.